Pleasure to take you on a walk through 50 years of my career, where I've come to a vision of what 21st century medicine should be, which includes big data and the analysis of individuals with genome sequencing and longitudinal phenome analyses. So the background for the Million Person Project in the 21st Century Medicine is started when I was an assistant professor at Caltech in 1970, thinking about what the future should be. One of the areas I was interested in is human biology and disease. And I was really at that time overwhelmed with the apparent complexity of deciphering the complexity of human biology. And this led me on a path to either lead or participate in seven paradigm changes in biology, leading with complexity, which led to my view of 21st century. And what is amazing is each of these seven paradigm changes in different ways allowed us to approach the challenge of complexity, but together they did frame what 21st century medicine should be. So the first paradigm change brought on in the first 30 years or so was to bring engineering to biology, in the sense I developed a series of six instruments that basically allowed you to sequence DNA and proteins and synthesize DNA and proteins. This gave us the ability for the first time to make high throughput measurements on humans. And this is a key part of being able to decipher their complexity. And of course, that data led to big data in its current analytics and plays obviously a central role in 21st century medicine. One of these instruments, the Genome Project, got me invited to the first meeting, ever held on the Human Genome Project in the spring of 1985, where 12 of us evaluated the project for whether we should go forward. And we came to the conclusion, one, it was technically feasible, though difficult at that time. And two, we were split 6-6, for and against it. Those against were vehemently against it because they saw it at the Human Genome Project as big science, which would destroy the then popular small science and all. This turned out not at all to be true. And in fact, what the Genome Project did when accomplished was give us the blueprint for being able to analyze the variability in humans against wellness and disease phenotypes. Now, developing the automated sequencer required that I brought into my lab computer scientists, engineers, chemists, and molecular biologists. And I realized that what we should do is actually have a department of biology that was cross-disciplinary in nature that could serve as a foundation for developing the technologies that were needed for deciphering human complexity. I proposed that to Caltech. Biology absolutely turned me down. I'll leave it to you as to why that might have been so. Bill Gates made it possible to move to the University of Washington and set it up. And in the 8 years of its existence, it was marvelously successful in developing pioneering new tools for genomics, the then emerging field of proteomics, cell biology, and the like. But I'd gone to the University of Washington with an idea of building on this cross-disciplinary framework, a systems biology center, and the bureaucracy of a large state university made that incredibly difficult to do. So in 2000, I resigned. I started the first Institute for Systems Biology in Seattle, nonprofit research independent. Institute that was entirely independent. And I used it to pioneer techniques for both biology and disease. But in many ways, one of the most important things I did was to, at the early 2000s, conceptualize just what 21st century medicine should be. And from a descriptive point of view, its most important features are that it should be predictive, preventive, personalized, and participatory. And I call that P4 medicine. And this 21st century medicine should have two domains, healthcare and wellness. Wellness and disease. And at that time, wellness was almost entirely ignored. We developed over the next 10 years or so a series of additional techniques. And then Nathan Price and I in 2014 persuaded 108 of our friends to undergo a 9-month process where we determined their complete genome sequence and did longitudinal phenome analyses, which I'll describe in a moment, that allowed us deep insights into optimizing their wellness. And we called this quantitative or scientific wellness. And it demonstrated the power of longitudinal data clouds for deciphering human complexity. The enthusiasm for this project was so great among the 108, we started a company called Aerovail in 2015 that brought scientific wellness to consumers. And over the next 4 years, we acquired 5,000 clients, each with their longitudinal data clouds. And of course, what this led to in the spring of 2016 was the CEO of Providence St. Joseph's Hospital, the third largest nonprofit healthcare system in the US, approaching me and asking me, one, to become chief science officer, and two, to affiliate ISB with Providence so they could learn systems thinking. The CEO was interested both in bringing genomics and scientific wellness to a large healthcare system. I agreed, and it opened up a whole realm of new kind of possibilities. So what exactly is this 21st century healthcare? It really is an N of one medicine where we look at each individual as an individual and we follow their health trajectory and optimize it. Now, a health trajectory for most people has three parts. There is a very long stage of wellness as we're young and hopefully for some of us middle age. And the purpose of 21st century medicine is to use scientific wellness and other features I'll describe to absolutely optimize and extend the length of our wellness trajectory. For almost all of us, we will transition from wellness to disease one or more times during our lifetime. And it turns out that we can actually detect these earliest transitions. And we argue that is the point at which 21st century medicine should reverse disease before it ever manifests itself as a disease phenotype. The disease is then simpler and it is far more optimal in assuring a longer wellness phenotype. If you do slip into disease progression, one notes that the disease perturbed networks that can be defined by the data become increasingly complex to the point where for most diseases, the first clinical signs are complex beyond any simple drugs being able, single drugs being able to deal with them simply. And in fact, that's what contemporary medicine deals with. They only deal with disease after diagnosis. The key is to predict early and prevent. And that is exactly what the essence of 21st century medicine is all about. The challenges, as you all know, of contemporary medicine are quality, our aging populations, the explosion of chronic diseases, particularly diabetes, obesity, and the like, and the accelerating costs of medicine. And this is particularly true in the US, where we turn out to be, in spite of the fact we spend a lot of money, more than anyone else, probably at the low end of the quality scale for healthcare. What is interesting is 21st century medicine has explicit approaches that can really attack each of these four challenges. So what exactly is this genome longitudinal phenome analysis we use both for the pilot program with 108 and for Aerofil with 5,000? We do the whole genome sequence. We analyze your blood, in the case of Aerofil, every 6 months. And we analyze about 1,200 analytes, both clinical chemistries, metabolites, and proteins. We analyze every 6 months your gut microbiome to quantify the species contained therein. And we use the digital device, the Fitbit, and other tracking devices for measuring quantized self-health. And these create data clouds for each individual that, when analyzed, allow us to go back to more than 400 actionable possibilities we have now, validated by the literature. And when an individual carries out the actionable possibility, they either improve their wellness or can begin to avoid disease. And we were able to demonstrate in both of these projects, the pilot and Aerofil, we were very successful in this scientific wellness, as we defined as quantitative wellness, by both objective and subjective criteria. The longitudinal data clouds were also incredibly powerful, as we will see. Over the last 10 years or so, we've been a pioneer in leading the analysis of longitudinal data clouds to give us fundamentally new and deep insights into human disease and human complexity. And I'll talk about just four of these. As I've already described, this scientific or quantitative wellness that we generated allowed us to create statistical correlations among the six different data types that gave us beautiful insights as to the coordinate interaction in a positive or a negative sense of many different systems. And that gave us deep insights into optimizing scientific wellness. Number two, we were able to bend the 5,000 individuals in the Aerofil population into 10-year decades, and from 20 to 30, 30 to 40, up to 80 to 90, and demonstrated that there was a linear decrease in ability to control analytes, all three classes, over this period of time. And we could use that to calculate a metric called biological age. That's the age your body says you are, rather than the age your birthday says you are. Ideally, the lower your biologic age is relative to your chronologic age, the better you're aging. I, for example, am 15 years younger than my chronologic age, and I'm a fanatic for exercise and proper diet and things like that. We demonstrated that 300 people in Aerofil with type 2 diabetes had biological ages that averaged 6 years older than their chronologic ages. For every year an individual was in Aerofil, they lost 1.25 years in biological age. And this was a striking validation of the success of scientific wellness and the ability of this metric to measure increasing scientific wellness. What is interesting about the metric is the analytes that we use to make the calculation can also be assessed for each individual to say how to optimize that biological age. So it leads to healthy aging, as we'll discuss in just a second. We can do genome-wide association scores that get converted into polygenic scores that deal with genetic risk. And we can actually calculated for 54 different diseases in the Aerofail population, their genetic risk, binning them from very low to very high. And we showed one, that if you were very high risk for a given disease and you have the disease, for example, high LDL cholesterol in the cholesterol polygenic score, then only chemistry, that is statins, brings down your cholesterol. If you're at low risk and have high cholesterol, diet and exercise work markedly. So the idea is, in the future, for most of these diseases, we'll treat people at low risk differently from people at high risk. And we can follow closely those at high risk to see and reverse their earliest transitions for disease. Finally, in this population, we saw 167 wellness to disease transitions, and we were able to validate in really striking ways how we can detect the earliest detectable transition, which in most cases is 2 to 5 or 6 years earlier than the actual clinical diagnosis. For example, in the data shown here, this woman had stage 4 pancreatic cancer in January of 2017. We had 4 prior blood draws. And what we did for each of them was to look at the 1,200 analytes individually in each case, comparing that analyte against the average of the 2,000 Aerofail clients we had at that time. And we were able beautifully to show for proteins there were outliers that were orders of magnitude away from the statistical norm. And these represented biomarkers for the transition. But the really important point is, all the way out to the earliest draw, we saw these proteins. So clearly the beginnings of the transition were probably 2 to 3 years prior to the time we began the measurements, more than adequate to think about how to use the biomarker to reverse the disease at that stage before it ever manifests itself. And so I just want to emphasize again, in addition to scientific wellness, we have a clear trajectory toward optimizing healthy aging, and we have the ability through early detection and reversal to eliminate chronic disease. And I won't say, I'll emphasize that this is still a challenging task, but the trajectory of what we need to do is crystal clear. So let me talk about Alzheimer's disease. This is a disease that had 400 clinical trials over the last 12 years. None of them succeeded. So pharma and biologists are just thinking in the wrong way about Alzheimer's disease. So what we propose to do is to take these genome-phenome analyses and analyze individuals at high risk for Alzheimer's and identify their earliest stage of transition. And we're beginning to set up this clinical trial as we speak. And what we plan to do then is at that earliest stage of transition, which PET scanning shows is somewhere between 4 and 10 years prior to any clinical diagnosis. So by the time you get a clinical diagnosis of Alzheimer's, you've had it for a long time. So we want to reverse that trend and go back to the very beginning. And what's happened that's been very interesting is Dale Bresidan pioneered the idea that optimizing synaptic communication can lead to a therapy that is 36 points in its regimen. And it includes a wide variety of things, drugs and supplements and lifestyle and exercise and the like. And it's called a multimodal therapy. He demonstrated for 100 observational patients at early stage of Alzheimer's, he could reverse about 85 of them back to relative normality. And there has been a second approach with an approach called Brain HQ that has the ability to restore cognitive features lost. And cognitive features can be reaction time, that can be depth of perception field, that can be memory, quite obviously. And it's had clinical trials. It's demonstrated its success in reducing high-risk Alzheimer's patients to go from wellness to disease. So we plan to use these multimodal therapies, and we've set up now three different clinical trials with ISB pioneering these integrated approaches together. And the preliminary results are very, very promising. So this is a forecast of what I predict will come with most major chronic diseases in the future. The Million Person Project is going to be the effector mechanism for actually instituting 21st century medicine. We plan to take 1 million patients and their physicians, and the challenge of recruiting and educating, consenting, and so forth is the biggest challenge in this project. We will, from each patient, take a sample, place it in the biobank, and then send aliquots to vendors that will do genome sequencing and the longitudinal phenotyping for us. We'll then reacquire that data and put it together with electronic health records into the cloud, a unique data cloud for each of the different patients, and use analytics, machine learning, AI, knowledge graphs to be able to translate data into knowledge that will be useful for physicians and their patients and for the partners in this process that will be of many diverse types, as we'll see in a moment. So what is going to be essential is to get partners that will help us in two ways. One, really three ways. One, execute the ability to generate the new data. Two, help us in the analysis of this data. And three, help pay for the generation of this data. And we've spoken with a host of different companies, and there is certainly interest in moving forward with this. Just a word about knowledge graphs, which are something relatively new. And conceptually, they're really very simple. They are nothing more than a database of all medical databases. So you can do one shop shopping for all medical knowledge. Now we have databases for almost every different big data feature, and you have to learn how to do them, navigate them, and figure out how to integrate them together. The knowledge graphs do all of that for us. And they give us the ability to take the patient's data and place it in the knowledge graph and begin to decipher with enormous accuracy exactly what has happened to that patient. It will enable in incredible ways 21st century medicine, this N of one medicine I spoke about. We see the organization of our collaborative data ecosystem organization as being a series of concentric circles where the innermost members of the circle have made the most fundamental contributions in data generation, in data analysis, and in contribution to the generation of the data. And the successive circles will have less responsibility, but we will bring in healthcare partners from every aspect of healthcare, payers, providers, technology companies, pharma, diagnostic companies, and the like. The data cloud will generate enormous assets. We plan to have them be open innovation. We'll gain insights through knowledge graphs, as I described. we've recruited really talented researchers and data scientists to implement this. We're beginning a program in physician education and participant education. We'll have the data commons, which will be a data generating engine that will throw off enormous new IP opportunities, insights, and knowledge for both wellness and disease. We'll have a pre-screened engaged population, a biobank of samples that will let us go back and test hypotheses. And of course, we'll use all the latest tools of IT to generate this. So we'll use biological data, social determinants of health, data claims, outcomes, and then finally their clinical records, electronic medical records, and integrate these all together to change completely how we learn about wellness and disease, how we organize and deliver care, how we measure price and manage risk, and how we handle innovation and develop new kinds of products. There are at least 8 other endeavors, probably 10 or 12 other endeavors, that primarily are focusing on genome analyses. And we've just compared those organizations and some of the ideal features they should have at the far left-hand side. And without going into a lot of detail here, I will say what is unique about the Million Person Project on the right is, one, it is driven by this vision of 21st century medicine. Two, it is the only one that's really had deep experience in omic analyses, the longitudinal omic analyses, and I really stress that. And three, it's the only one that meets all of the ideal features listed for these types of endeavors. Why is Providence a good partner for us? It's geographically diverse, spread from Alaska all the way down the West Coast, Montana, and south in the U.S. But I think even more important than that geographical distribution, which gives us enormous ethnic diversity, is the idea that they have 14 million patients, 25,000 physicians, and a C-suite that is engaged in this million person endeavor. And it is going to take leadership and strong leadership to make this happen in really an effective manner. What is interesting is we've already begun. We started in 2020, January, with a 5,000 person patient pilot to learn how to do all the things I've described, which was interrupted by COVID-19 pandemic. And we've delayed this until the fall or winter. Probably it's going to be the first part of next year now with the reemergence of the third wave of COVID here in the state of Washington. But the important point is this COVID-19 pandemic has been an enormous opportunity to learn new approaches to dealing with disease. Together with Jim Heath, we created an observational study in February using genome phenome analyses and for the first time, very deep immune phenotyping. And it's the grand disruptor and enabler of the Million Person Project, as you'll see. So 300 patients, blood draws at diagnosis, 10 days, and then at convalescence. It includes lots of different races. The assays, the unique one, the deep immunologic phenotyping, we've taken 5,000 white blood cells from each blood draw for each patient, and we've done single cell analysis on them. The transcriptome, 200 cell surface proteins, secreted cytokines, their T and or B cell receptors, their HLA antigen presenting receptors, and so forth. And it's been transformational in what we've learned. And it means we can take patients as they enter the hospital at any state. And because we have deep insights into the progress of the disease, we can align the stages and identify unique trajectories for each of the drugs through this deep immune phenotyping. We have a paper in Cell on Press on our analysis of the first 129 of these patients. So the observational study was transformational in that it catalyzed an instant response from Providence, and we had the study going within a few weeks of its proposal. Number two, we recruited outstanding immunologists from across academia in the US to help us interpret the deep phenotype data. We recruited about 10 small companies to help us with unique aspects of the data generation. And we've fundamentally changed how pharma looks at these kinds of clinical trials. With Merck, I went to the number two in command. And within 20 minutes of describing the deep immunologic phenotyping, he'd agreed to fund the study and move ahead with an open architecture and immediate release of data, as did Novartis and Gilead. So we were able, with these resources, to build a support team of computer scientists and clinical scientists that are exactly what we need, not only for COVID, but for the billion person project as well. So three patients infected two times. The first one infected with the Asian virus initially, then the European virus. And the second time, we demonstrated antibodies from the Asian virus didn't work very well with the European virus. And that certainly has implications. And again, we could show Caucasians and Asians had different antigen-presenting receptors, and these receptors saw different viral epitopes. And of course, this has implications as well. In mildly affected patients, we showed almost the complete loss of essential amino acids and a whole series of fatty acids and phospholipids and other agents that are used to build cells. And we think this comes about at this very early stage of the disease as a result of the virus signaling, build me a lot of immune cells, and the body scavenging the reagents for this and running short. And this leads to obvious clinical trials. We can follow shifts in the killer cell phenotypes, the CD8 phenotypes, that give us insights into disease progression and resolution. We've defined new types of helper and killer cells, and we're looking at what they might be about. And finally, we've done deep analysis of two drugs that are most often used where we can see their trajectories. And we can actually now begin to talk about how to optimize the clinical trials that will exhibit the best features of these two drugs. So the final point is this high dimensional data, especially from immune phenotyping, means the deductions from a single patient are powerful. And we went, as we moved from 30 to 100 patients, we showed that we'd been already able to generate most of the profound new insights into the disease. And with the insights at 100 patients, we could go into the millions of electronic medical records of Providence, identify 15,000 with COVID, and begin to do simple clinical surrogates for some of the transitions we saw in this disease. And I think this is going to lead to a redesign of more effective clinical trials in the future, as I said, that can lead to early FDA approval. The deep phenotyping can be done for immune, metabolic, hormonal, neurologic, various systems. And we think that's going to transform our understanding of most chronic diseases in the future. The business opportunities are really striking. And here I've just listed opportunities for the clinic, opportunities for IP, opportunities for clinical research. And without going into any details, some are very early, some are intermediate, and some come at later stages. But that opportunities are absolutely striking, and I'll talk about a few of the best ones. We'll have completely new clinical trials that can be enormously informative at the same time they follow the drug. And the prototype, of course, is what I've talked to you here about COVID with. We're going to move scientific wellness from the hospital to the consumer and have a consumer-based scientific wellness and healthy aging rubric. We're going to be able to actually do clinical studies with deep phenotyping, as I've described, for all major kinds of chronic diseases. We'll be able easily to get biomarkers for disease and patient stratification for companion diagnostics, and of course, for the wellness to disease transitions to be able to reverse those. We'll have two-step clinical trials in the future where the first 100 patients are used to identify biomarkers that can indicate which are the responder patients. And those biomarkers can be used to select 100 responders to do the second clinical trial at a very high success rate, guaranteeing FDA approval. We're going to use AI-based recommendations because the million person project will generate thousands of new actionable possibilities. And we have to be able to deliver those unique for each patient to the physician in a prioritized and descriptively revealed manner that the physician can use these effectively. And this is what AI really is all about. We can also use the statistically based correlation approaches I mentioned with scientific wellness to actually help pharma take an entirely new approach to biomarker and drug target discovery. And finally, we're developing a microfluidic device that's 100% at home test administered that uses saliva you collect yourself, results under an hour, no risk burden on the healthcare providers, and it uses a lamp technology that is linear in its amplification, and the detection device is an impedance-matched microfluidic device that works beautifully. We will mass produce a two-component device, a disposable test module that will cost about $1, and a reusable detection module will cost $2. So that's $3 against, at least in the US, $125 or more dollars. And you can do the test as often as you want to do it. And it also allows us to do multiplexing. So we'll be devising tests that can simultaneously detect whether you have flu and or influenza, flu and or COVID or both. So with that, the take-home lesson is 21st century medicine is about following and optimizing the individual health trajectory. Some of the innovations from the Million Person Project will be thousands of new action possibilities, the ability to widespread apply the tools of pharmacogenomics, that is the ability to identify which drugs work and which fail to work for an individual. Mendelian recessives in the heterozygous form, as we've shown for hemochromatosis, on some occasions may get the disease. And knowing that you're recessive, you can follow for this possibility in 7,000 or more Mendelian recessive variants. And the microfluidic device I've described, research, we can do genome longitudinal phenome clinical trials, or we can add that to deep phenotyping clinical trials as we did with COVID. And we want to be able to use the wellness to disease transitions to find the biomarkers and the therapeutics to reverse for all chronic diseases. And finally, I think the innovation business opportunities are really unbounded. The biobank will be unbelievably valuable as the longitudinality of these data clouds is extended. And the data ecosystem is going to throw off enormous possibilities. And I think 21st century leadership for early adopters. So we can go back and say for quality, aging population, explosion of chronic disease cost, the challenges of contemporary medicine, we have powerful and in many cases already demonstrated effective solutions to being able to deal with these effectively. And of course, with regard to cost, everything you do as illustrated above will reduce the cost of healthcare. So I think 21st century medicine, the P4 vision of medicine is going to provide many additional clear challenges, approaches for each challenge we've given here. So thank you for your patience. This is where you can get me if you have any questions.